Today we're going to talk about the RepRap discount full graphics smart controller on the Big Tree Tech Octopus version 1.1. Now this also applies to the Big Tree Tech Octopus Pro, but I want to show you on this board just for simplicity. So a couple of things that we need to know about this actual display are kind of simple. So if we look at the display right here, you can see there is a potentiometer for contrast, but we're not really ever going to use that. There's also a stop, or sometimes it's called a reset button. Then we have a piezo buzzer, which sometimes I call an actual speaker, but that doesn't really matter. Then we have a potentiometer that we can turn and then click down to select a menu. Now on the back end of this, there's a couple of things that I want to point out. First of all, we have EXP1, and then on the other side, EXP2. We also have our SD card reader over here. So this tutorial is going to be a little bit longer than normal because they've changed the way they implemented the actual reading of files for G-codes. So I'm going to go through a couple of those options for you. So it might look like I'm making mistakes, but it's designed to actually show you what's occurring. Then over in here, we have on our Big Tree Tech Octopus board, the EXP1 and EXP2, which in theory will match up directly with these ports. So to hook these up, I need to grab two ribbon cables, which have notched connections. So as you can see here, there's a notch connection. So in order to install this, what we'll do is we'll turn it this way and insert it so the notch is facing this way. Then we'll do the same over here with the notched connector. And then we'll do the same exact operation for EXP2. So we'll slide it in there. We'll take the notch connection and connect it over here. Now to check to see if it's working, what we can do is actually power the board. So I left on the USB jumper so that we can power the board. So I'm going to plug this in over in here and we'll see what happens. So it looks like it does power up. Currently we don't have firmware installed that specifies this display, but I'll show you how to do that in just a second. Now I already pre-placed the actual USB card for the micro USB over from here in here. So I'm going to place this in the computer so you may hear a beep. I'm actually going to disconnect the power for a moment on here, and then we'll go over to the desktop. So on the desktop, what you can see is that we're in VS Code or Visual Studio Code. And to load the firmware, which I've already downloaded from the Marlin site and extracted, I'm going to click on Explorer, Open Folder, then I'm going to go to Downloads, Marlin 2.1, Marlin 2.1, and then I'm going to say Select Folder. So in here, we have to do the same thing as usual. We have to go to the Marlin folder, then the Source folder, then the Core folder, then Boards.h. Inside here, we'll search on Octopus. And as you can see, there's three models of it. Now, the reason there's three models are there's different chipsets that are used for the MCU. So you can see that there's actually two of them between the three boards. So the way to check that is we can go back over to the workbench, and written on the actual MCU, you'll see one of those chipsets. If a new one is added, they will add it to the actual firmware either right away or eventually. So let's go back over to the desktop. We know this is our version being 1.1, so we'll copy it. We'll make note that it's an STM32F446. It's actually the STM32F4 that we're interested in. So keep that in mind, it will be relevant in a moment. So I'm going to minimize core, source, I'm going to go to configuration.h. I'm going to do a control F and search on motherboard. Now we're going to highlight the ramps and hit control V to paste our board type in here. Next, we have to set the serial communication to the board to -1. Now, a lot of people will tell me that you should use this one. They do the exact same thing. We're going to stick to 250,000 bits per second. And in order to configure the actual display, we're going to have to search on, I believe it's LCD and SD support. Now, for many of my viewers, they may want to change the actual language. So there's obviously Poliska, there's Francais or French, there's DE, which is German or Deutschland. And then we have, of course, Ukrainian in here someplace. It's UR, I think. There it is, UK, pardon me. So they do spell them out over in here, and this runs over to the other side. So you can actually check to see what language is what. So let's go back over to where we were. And we're gonna leave it in English for the moment. Then what we can do is we can actually enable SD support so we can actually use the SD card. So I'm gonna hit the control forward slash to enable. Now, there's obviously different language types that you can use. I'm not going to cover this. I'll let you figure that out on your own. And then there's also this that you can enable. This is in case it's not working, but most of the time I don't do it anymore. And then there's obviously different menu types, and there's lots of menu types. So I'm not going to cover that in this tutorial. The reason being is there's BL touch menu types, there's different types of leveling. Eventually I'll build a list and possibly put it up on Patreon for my patrons so that they actually can see that. But essentially there's other things in here you can do with like reversing the direction that it scrolls and everything else, but I'm gonna leave that alone for now. We do need to enable the buzzer if we're ever going to use it. In this case, they call it the speaker. That's the piezo buzzer. So control forward slash. That'll make a noise on certain operations. You can also leave it off by doing control forward slash again. But we'll just leave it alone for now. So to actually use this display, we're going to have to search on RepRap. Underscore full. There we go. It's actually right down here. That's the first one. That is not ours. It's actually going to be the second. But unfortunately, it's not letting us copy. So we're going to copy the discount smart part. And we'll do a find on that to get us to where we want to be. And apparently, it's not working, but I know it's in this neighborhood. So we just have to find the RepRap Full Graphics Smart Controller. And apparently I'm going to be a little bit lost here. So we'll do full underscore graphics. And that'll bring us to the one that we're actually looking for. So it's right here. So we'll do a control forward slash to enable it. And now this is enabled. So to build, what we're going to need to do is actually go to the platformio.ini, and we're going to have to update our default environment. Now, I told you to remember what our chipset was, so it's STM32F4.ini. So we'll search in here for Octopus, and as you can see, this is our chipset that we're currently working with, so I'm going to copy that, then I'll close out of here. Go to platformio.ini, and I'll paste this right here. Then what I'll do is I'll do a clean to clean out the old build that was up here in the .pio folder, and then I'll click the checkbox to actually build. Now what you need to keep in mind is when this is building, if there's an error the first time, it might mean that something is building out of order. So you're going to have to click the checkbox in order to do it a second time. If it does appear after the second time, go to the very first error in red that you see here and correct the issue, then rebuild. All the other issues thereafter, when you see the red, are generally a cascade of errors related to the first one. Now, if you see yellow, you can ignore it. And the reason that is because it's just a warning and that's normal. So as you can see, yellow just scrolled by. We don't have to actually worry about that error right here. So in a second, we'll see our actual build with firmware.bin appear in here, which we can then copy to our drive. So if we look in this folder right here, you'll see firmware.bin. We can right click on this and say reveal in file explorer. Now we already have a previous load that took place over here. So I'm going to right click and I'm going to send this to the USB drive. So if this is successful loading, it will then be renamed to firmware.cur. If you ever want to reload the same build, you'll rename it back to firmware.bin. So I'm going to pop up the drive and load the firmware and we'll see what happens. So just took the drive out. I'm going to place it in here and I'm going to power this via USB. So watch the actual display over here. It should say the version of Marlin that we're working with and Marlin, if we enabled it correctly. Then what we can do is we can actually test to see if there's media in it. Now I did place media on the drive, but if we scroll through here, it says no media. So there's a solution to this problem. What it involves is me disconnecting this. This is due to a change in Marlin that took place about a year ago. So I'm going to place this back on the drive and then place this back on the computer. So on the computer, I'm going to have to go to the advanced tab that we have over in here. So you have the configuration advanced. Now we're going to search on, I believe it's onboard. And you'll see that there's an actual functionality that is disabled for the SD card. Now, currently you have three options that you can do. Usually these two are the easiest. So I'm going to do control forward slash, and that will enable it. So let me get rid of one of these in a second, see if I can close it. Well, I'm going to ignore that for the moment. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to hit the checkbox again. Now this will say LCD. Originally the LCD would not display anything, or maybe it would, but we can test that before we're loading it. So what I'll do is I'll actually power it up and use the other drive that I have actually sitting here and seeing if it works. So we'll do that right now while this is building. So on the actual display, we're not reloading firmware, but what we're going to do is take this drive and place it in here and see if it works. So it might default to this drive because they seem to be changing this often. So we'll click here, see change media, print media. So currently it does exist. So we know that we can see it here, but now what I'll do is I'll actually show you how to do this on board, meaning the board that we're working with right here, because it's not going to show up when we load it. So I'll disconnect this for a second. I'll actually go back over to the desktop. I'm actually going to change this so that we can do it on board by right clicking, copying, pasting it right here, and then clicking build again. Now, the reason that I'm doing this way is because I made a mistake and that I didn't realize it's defaulting here now. I thought it originally defaulted to onboard, but we'll see if that actually works. Now, there's probably other functionality in here that I'm not going to cover, which you can cover on your own, but at least this gets you rolling in the direction that you want to go. So you can see the contrast between where you're actually seeing the information. So what we're going to do is we're going to go over to the .pio, the build folder, and we're going to wait for the bin, which just showed up. We'll reveal in File Explorer. We'll double check this drive. And what we'll do is right click and we'll send that to the USB. So now I'm going to pop that out and actually install it in here again. So I'm going to plug this in and I'm going to take this drive out, place it there, and we'll see if we see media again. So 2.1. Click here, print from media, and as you can see, we now have the media over in here. So there's one last thing I wanted to show you, and that's a G-code so you can actually see what's going on. So I'm gonna have to bring something up. So over in here, we need to connect to the board because we're gonna use G-codes. So the G-codes that I'm talking about, first let's locate the board. So I'm gonna type over in here, device manager, and press enter. And we're gonna locate the actual COM port, which is 21. So it may be in the dropdown, which it is in this case. So we'll click connect. It does say the printer is now online. So we need the G code, which is actually listed over in here on Marlin's G code website. So it's M20. So let's see what happens when we try that command. So we can type M20. What it does is it actually shows us the actual file names. Now you can do long file names, I believe. It's inside of VScode, but it's been a while since I've done it, so I'd have to search on it. So let's do a Control F, long file. Let's do this. LCD and let's see if it's in here. It's been a while since I've looked for it, so I might scroll past it. Let's see if we can do a search on it. Let's try going back up. So apparently I'm not gonna find it like I normally do. So there used to be a functionality, maybe I'm wrong, but at this moment, I just want to take a moment to thank you for watching the tutorial. And please remember to like and subscribe. And for my patrons and people on PayPal, I will post your names at the very end of the tutorial to thank you. So everyone take care, be safe, and I'll talk to you later.